Hello and welcome. In this lesson, I'm going to show you how to use a few more user interface controls and layout containers so that we can actually build a user interface. All right, let's dive right in. Hi there, my name is Chris, and if this is your first time to the channel, welcome to Code with Chris, where we help beginners build apps even if they've never written a single line of code. Now, before we start, I have a quick question for you. Prior to SwiftUI, did you like building your UI using storyboards or programmatically? Let me know by leaving a quick comment below. And on your way down there, if you wouldn't mind, I would really appreciate it if you gave this video a quick like. It really helps me out. Thank you so much. All right, with that said, let's do this. So here I've got a basic SwiftUI project. Let's first go through the image element. And this is what you use to display image assets in your project. Let's go ahead and add some to our asset library. So go ahead and click that. If you have your own images, you can go ahead and add that. If you don't, check in this description below to grab these images, which I have right here. I'm gonna go ahead and click drag them all like that. So it's just an apple, a donut, and a lemon. And take note of the asset names, all lowercase, apple, donut, and lemon, because we're going to need to refer to these asset names. And we're gonna change this text label element. Actually, we're just going to erase this right now. And we're gonna add an image element. And there are a couple of different initializers you can use. The one we're going to do here is called name, and you just pass in a string indicating the name of the image asset that you want. So we can do apple. Let's go ahead and hit resume there. So that is how easy it is to display an image asset on the screen. Let's go ahead and change it. And there you get a donut. Now let's take a look at the button element, because you do want to add some user interaction to your app. Let's go ahead and delete that. And let's create a button. Now this button initializer has a couple of parameters which you have to add to actually. So one is action. This block of code that you're going to add in here will indicate what the button does when it gets tapped. And the label right here, this block of code is going to describe what the button looks like. So you can put a text label in there to represent the button. You can put an image or anything you'd like there. So let's go ahead and open up the action. And for this, we're not going to go into how to write code for the button action just yet, because that's going to come a couple of lessons later. But for the label, what we're going to want to do, and it actually just takes that parameter out and opens up a trailing closure. Inside this trailing closure, you can actually put different elements that you'd like. For example, I want to put a text label. Let's run that simulator, and then you get a button that has this text label as the button. Or you can put an image, like let's say that donut that we had. So let's go ahead and do that. And you're gonna see a donut for the button. Now, it's all blue, it's tinted blue, because that's actually the default, I guess, tint or foreground color for buttons. If you are going to use an image as a button, then you actually have to set a rendering mode modifier here. And we're gonna get into modifiers in the next lesson, but right here is kind of a little preview of that. So we're gonna select original. And modifiers, just very quickly, is something that you can use to change the look, behavior, or the position, the placement of the element. Essentially, it modifies the element. I don't wanna get too much into it because we're gonna cover it in the next lesson. So then this is how you're going to use an image as a clickable button. Now, you'll notice that every time I'm showing you an element, I am deleting the existing one and adding a different one. And the reason for that is because if you try to add two elements onto your user interface like this, you try and run it, you're going to get an error, because this body right here, it expects a single view back. Now, the way you're going to have multiple elements in your user interface is that you're going to have to use layout containers to group these different elements together and have a single root element that satisfies this return type right here. So let's go ahead and talk about our first layout container, which is something called a VStack. And if you've used stack views before in UIKit, this is exactly what a VStack is. And V stands for vertical. So let's declare a new VStack. And actually, I'm not going to declare it this way. I am going to create a new VStack object so that I can show you what sort of parameters you can pass in. So for example, you can pass in an alignment. By default, everything inside the VStack will be aligned to the center. So I'm just going to go ahead and hit, I'm just going to do center. And spacing allows you to indicate how much space you want to put between all of the elements inside of the VStack. So maybe by default, I'll put 10, 20. And then the content here, this closure, if you open it up, it's going to turn it into a trailing closure and take it out of the parameter list. In here, you're going to put all of the elements you want to stack together. So I'm going to go ahead and take my button and my text label and put them in there. And then we're just going to wait for that to update. So here you can see I can put multiple elements onto the view. I've got the text element here and I've got the button, which is a really bad button because you can't even tell it's a button. But I've got two elements on the screen and they're stacked one on top of another. And that's what the VStack helps you with. Now, if you don't need to specify an alignment, then you can, and you don't need to specify spacing, you can go ahead and actually just get rid of those. Those are optional parameters and you can just have VStack and then you can have the opening curly bracket and the closing curly bracket, and then all of your elements inside. And you can actually stack more things if you'd like. So the other one, which we talked about was an image, right? And this is going to make it even more confusing because now you can't tell which one's a button and which one's just an image, but this is just for example purposes. Now, another one we have, another layout container that we have is called the HStack. And you guessed it, H stands for horizontal. So now you can see automatically everything is side by side. And again, it has the same parameter list. You can align things by default to the center, but you can align it to the top or the bottom. And you can also specify spacing. Now, one thing I do want to point out is that even if we specify a parameter, let's say top, and let's say the spacing is 20 and the content parameter we already have, which is right here. Even if I did that, you can see that the text label now gets aligned to the top. But if you were expecting everything to get pushed up to the very top, you would be mistaken because the height of the stack view, or even the general size of that, I just said stack view, didn't I? The HStack, the size of that, it is only as big as it needs to be to accommodate the elements inside of it. It's not going to take up all of the space on the screen on its own. If you wanted to do that, you can use another element called a spacer. And this element is simply to take up as much space as it can. Now, if I wanted to push my HStack elements here all the way to the top, I don't add a spacer inside my HStack because remember, inside an HStack, everything is side by side. So my spacer would just simply push everything off to the left there. If I wanted to push everything to the top, I would actually have to put the spacer underneath my HStack to take up all of that space. So the way I'm going to do that is I'm going to add the spacer element first, and it simply looks like that. But I'm going to get an error now because again, now I have two root views, right? I have an HStack and I have a spacer, and this is expecting a single view. Well, the easy way to fix this is to wrap everything in a VStack. Like that, all right? So opening bracket there. Actually, I'll do it this way so it's a little bit easier to follow. And I'll cut all of that and put it inside my VStack. See, then everything gets pushed up because here we have my HStack, right, as the first element in my VStack. And then the spacer literally just consumes all of the space that it can. And so my VStack now, I've got it highlighted. You can see it as this blue outline. It takes up all of the space. Now, similarly, my HStack is centered. It only goes from here to here. If I wanted to, let's say, push everything to the left-hand side, I could add a spacer inside my HStack. So let's put it to the right of the button. And once it updates, you're gonna see my spacer is here. It takes up all of the space that's available and pushes everything to the left. Now, one thing I do wanna mention about the spacer element is that it shares the space with other spacer elements in the same layout container. So let me give you a quick example of this. I'm just gonna get rid of all of this first. I'm gonna put a text element and I'm just gonna say hello. All right, so if I just update that, you can see hello. And let's say I wrap it in a VStack. And then I put another hello element and let's just have three. So you can see that my VStack is right there in the center of the screen. It's vertically and horizontally centered and it's got three hello text elements inside there. See, if I add a spacer at the bottom, what do you think would happen? Right, it would take up all of its space, thereby pushing all of those elements to the top. Well, what would happen if I add a spacer at the top here? Well, the space would actually be divided evenly between the two spacers because they're both competing to take up all the space, so they both get equal amounts. Now I can add another spacer here, and now I have three spacers, and you can see that the spacers actually consume the same amount of space. So this one here, and this one here. Now if I add a fourth one, they all consume equal spaces. So this can be a neat way to center elements and make sure that they're spread out evenly and that things look really nice and proper. Now before I leave you with a quick exercise, I wanna show you one more layout container, and that is the ZStack, or ZStack as we say here in Canada. So I'm gonna change this V to a Z, and now it looks like all of our elements are gone. Well, actually what a ZStack does is that it puts elements on top of each other. So if I change the text, you're going to be able to see this reflected. Let's see, this is the very back. This is the middle, and you can see it's starting to get jumbled, and this is the front. So you can see things are just laid out one on top of the other. So this is what ZStack is for. It's good for putting, let's say, a background and then elements on top of a background, right? I could change this very back label to an image, and let's say this is gonna be the lemon. And then that way it's might be a little easier to illustrate for you. Let's say I have the apple in the middle, and let's say I have the donut in the front. So you can actually see that the things are stacked on top of each other now. Oh, I forgot to change this to an image element. So there we go. So the ZStack is really great, like I said, for putting an image as a background and then having elements on top, or some graphic elements inside of your app might be comprised of several smaller image assets, and you can use the ZStack to stack them together to create the overall look and feel that you're looking for. All right, now that you know about these several layout containers and elements, I'm gonna give you a quick exercise for you to try to achieve. All right, so here's the exercise. It doesn't matter what graphic images you used, but I want you to create a 3x3 grid with everything evenly spaced. So you'll notice that every single row, there is equal space in between each row, as well as from the bottom of the screen and from the top of the screen. And also for each row, every single element has equal space in between them here, from the left edge, between these elements right here, and also from the right edge. I highly encourage you to try it out. It's going to reinforce what you learned in this lesson. In the next lesson, I'll show you how to use modifiers to, well, modify the behavior, appearance, and position of your elements. If you enjoyed this lesson and you don't want to miss the next one, make sure you're subscribed to the channel and turn on bell notifications as well, so you can get notified when the next video comes out. All right, I'll see you in the next lesson.